2,500 public jobs in USA, Canada, UK, Italy, major parts of the Middle East, Australia, New Zealand, South Africa, Botswana, Singapore, Hong Kong, Thailand, Guyana, Trinidad, Mauritius, and many other countries, including our beloved Malaysia. In addition to numerous jobs in Indonesia, Dr. Zakir Naik was featured in the Indian Express list of the 100 most powerful Indians in 2009 and again in 2010. In the special list in 2009 of the top 10 spiritual gurus in India, Dr. Zakir Naik was ranked at number 3. Dr. Zakir Naik has been placed in the top 62 in the list of the 500 most influential Muslims in the world, published by the George Washington University in the United States of America. Dr. Zakir Naik appears regularly on many international TV channels in more than 200 countries in the world. The ideology and driving force behind this TV network is himself, Dr. Zakir Naik. He launched Peace TV English in January 2006, it being the largest watched Islamic as well as religious satellite TV channel presently in the world, with over 100 million viewership, of which more than 25% are non-Muslims. In Itfusat, he launched Peace TV Urdu in 2008 and Peace TV Bangla in 2011. Wow! I will be lying to you if I tell you I am not happy standing here before you today. I am truly honored to welcome our beloved brother, Dr. Zakir Naik, to the stage.
Wassalamu ala ala wa sahbihi. Amma a'udhu billahi min shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Ya ayyuhan nas inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lit'arafu. Innaka lahum min ruhikum inna lahum nakhbin. Rabbi shrah li sadri. Wa yassir li amri. Wa hlul 'uqdatan min lisani yafqahu qawli. My brothers and my dear brothers and sisters, I welcome all of you for the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, be on all of you. This is my fourth lecture tour to Malaysia. I've been earlier 3 times. I've been twice before, in 96, 98, and 2001. And I'm coming again after a span of over 11 and a half years. And it's a pleasure for me to be back in here in Corona. The topic of this evening's talk of mine is universal brotherhood. There are various different types of brotherhood. Brotherhood based on blood relationship. Brotherhood based on region. Based on race. Brotherhood based on caste, on creed, on color. But all these brotherhoods, they are limited and they are not universal. And Islam does not believe that human beings should be divided based on color and caste. I started my talk by quoting also the words of Quran from Surah Hujurat, chapter 49. Verse number 13, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhan nasu inna khalaqnakum min dhakarin wa untha wa ja'alnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lit'arafu. Innaka lahum min ruhikum inna lahum nakhbin. O humankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female and have divided you into nations and tribes so that you shall recognize each other. And you may not despise each other. And the most honor in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the person who has taqwa. The person who has God consciousness, piety, righteousness. Allah says in this verse that He has divided the human beings into different types, into tribes, so that you may recognize each other, not that you may despise each other. And the most honored in the sight of Almighty Allah is the person who has taqwa, God consciousness, righteousness, piety. Allah says in Surah chapter 30, verse 32, that amongst His signs, He has created the heaven and the earth and has created you in different languages and has created different languages and colors. Verily in it is a sign for those who understand. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created people in different colors, having different languages, so that we can recognize each other. And this is a sign for those who understand. Allah says in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 17, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored all the children of Adam, irrespective whether you are black or white, yellow or brown, rich or poor, coming from America or Malaysia or India or Pakistan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored all the Bani Adam, all the children of Adam. And besides Islam, there are other religions who believe that the humankind originated from a single pair of male and female, from Adam and Eve. Smell between them. repeat me about them. But unlike Islam, the other religion, they believe it is the woman because of which humankind is born in sin. Because Eve, may Allah be pleased with her, she disobeyed God, that is the reason human beings are born in sin. In Islam, we do not put the blame only on the woman. In Islam, if you read the Quran, the blame is equally put on both of them. Allah mentions in Surah Isra, chapter number 17. Allah also mentions in Surah Araf, chapter number 7, verse number 19 and 27. Where Adam and Eve, peace be upon them, both of them are addressed more than a dozen times. Both of them made a mistake, both of them repented, both were forgiven. The blame is equally put on both of them. There is not a single verse in the Quran which puts the blame only on Eve. May Allah be pleased with her. But there is a verse in the Quran which only singles out Adam, peace be upon him. Allah says in Surah Taha, chapter number 20. Verse number 121, that Adam peace be upon him, he disobeyed Allah. But if you read the Quran as a whole, the blame is equally put on both of them. There are other religions who say that because of the sin of the woman, pregnancy is a curse on the woman. And Almighty God, according to other religions, they say that the woman bears labor pains. Pain because of sin. Pregnancy degrades the woman in other religions. But in Islam, it's the opposite. Pregnancy uplifts the woman. Allah says in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse number 1, respect the woman and the woman. Allah says in Surah Luqman, chapter number 31, verse number 15, that we have ordained the human beings to be good to their parents. In travail upon travail is the mother of them, and in years to be those to be. Allah says this in Araf, chapter 46, verse 15. We have enjoyed on the human beings to be good to the parents. In pain is the mother of you, and in pain is she gives birth. So pregnancy appears for you. Does not be greater. And the Lord God also said, Sahih is a Bukhari, point number 8. Chapter number 2, Book of Adab, Hadith number 2. A man approached the Prophet and asked him, said, who deserves the maximum love and companionship in this world? The Prophet said, your mother. The man asked after that too. The Prophet repeated, your mother. The man asked after that too. Again the Prophet said, your mother. The man asked for the fourth time, who next? Then the Prophet said, your father. In short, 75%, 3/4 of the love and companionship goes to the mother, 25%, 1/4 goes to the father. In short, the father gets the gold medal, she gets the silver medal, as well as the bronze medal. The father has to be satisfied with the way of consolation guys. I have to mention something about women, right? In the lecture of universal brotherhood, though my son, father, I believe, may have done more justice to this topic. I just want to mention again that in Islam, men and women are equal, but equality does not mean identity. They're equal, but they are not identical. In some aspects, the men have a degree of equality. In some aspects, the women have a different advantage. And I will repeat the example given by my son, that if in a class, two students A and B, both get 80 out of 100, both were first in the class, and if we analyze the answer sheet, there are 10 answers to 10 questions. In answer to question number 1, student A gets 9 out of 10, and student B gets 10 out of 10. So student A has the degree of advantage over B in answer number 1. In answer to question 2, student B gets 9 out of 10 and student A gets 10 out of 10. So in answer to question number 2, student B has the degree of advantage over A. All the remaining answers number 3 to question number 10, all the remaining 8 answers, both A and B, get 8 out of 10. So if you add up, today A also gets 8 out of 100, today B also gets 8 out of 100. But student A has the advantage over B in answer number 1, and student B has the advantage over A in answer number 2. But overall, both are equal. Similarly, in Islam, men and women are equal, but equality doesn't have equality. In some aspects, the men have an equal advantage. In some aspects, the women have an equal advantage. For example, before Allah enters my house, I don't tell my wife or my daughter, go and fight because I believe in women's civilization, I believe in equality. Since Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, verse 35, that Allah has given more strength to the male as compared to the female. So here, in strength, the men have a legal advantage, and in their duty, that they have to correct the women. As far as love and companionship of the children to the parents are concerned, as the Quran says earlier, the mother has 3 times more advantage as compared to the father. So overall, men and women in Islam are equal, but equality does not mean equality. In Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who we believe is Almighty God, is not exclusively God only for the Muslims or the Arabs. He is Almighty God for all the world, for all the human beings. Whether black or white, yellow or brown, rich or poor, whichever part of the world they live. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Fatiha, chapter number 1, verse number 2, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. Praise be to Allah, the Lord of the world, or of all the worlds. Allah says in Surah Nas, chapter 114, verse number 1, Qul a'udhu Rabbil Nas. Rabbil Nas is the Lord of humankind, of all the human beings. We believe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the Lord of all the human beings. And there are guidelines given in the Quran to promote universal love. Allah says in Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse 32. If anyone kills any other human being, unless it be for murder or for spreading corruption in the land, it is as though you have killed the whole of humanity. And if anyone saves a single human being, it is as though you have saved the whole nation. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if you kill any other human being, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, unless it be for murder or for spreading corruption in the land, if you kill any innocent human being, it is as though you have killed the whole of humanity. And if you save any human being, whether Muslim or non-Muslim, it is as though you have saved the whole nation, all the human beings. Therefore, in Islam, murder is one of the major sins in Islam. This disrupts universal law. Therefore, Islam prohibits killing any Muslim human being is prohibited. Allah also says that robbing is prohibited. Allah says to Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse 38, that a man and woman should not rob. And the third pillar of Islam is zakat. That is, every rich human being who has a saving of more than the nisab level, more than 85 grams of gold, he or she should give 2.5% of that excess wealth to charity every year. If every rich human being in the world gives zakat, poverty will be eradicated from this world. There will not be a single human being who will die of hunger. Zakat and charity increases the universal wealth and increases the gap between the rich and the poor. Allah says in Surah Maun, chapter number 107, verse 1-7. أَلَيْتَ الَّذِي يُقَسْمُ الْمِدِينِ وَصَالِكَ الَّذِي يَرُضُ الْيَدِينِ وَلَا يَهُمْ وَلَا قَوْمِ الْمِسْكِينِ فَوَيْلٌ لِلْمُسَلِّينِ الَّذِينَ مُصَرَاتِهِمْ سَهُمْ الَّذِينَ مُجَوَاقُونَ إِلَّهُمْ indigent. Woe to those who are neglectful of the prayers. Woe to those who pray only to be seen by men. And they do not even provide neighborly needs. Allah says, if you provide neighborly needs, it encourages the love. It is the duty of Muslims to help the neighbor. And I'm glad that what Muslim said, that he is not a Muslim who sleeps with his full stomach while the neighbor is hungry. That means Islam does not give you permission to sleep with a full tummy when your neighbor is hungry, when your neighbor doesn't have food to eat. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Isra, chapter number 17, verse number 26 and 27, that do not be a spendthrift, do not be extravagant in spending money. For verily, a spendthrift is the brother of the devil. But if you are a spendthrift, it discourages the universal brother. And being a spendthrift is a sign of the brother of the devil. Allah says in Surah Bashar, chapter 2, verse 188, that spend not your wealth as a bait for the judges in order to eat up other people's wealth. Here Allah says in Surah Bashar, chapter 2, verse 188, that bribing is prohibited, which is very common in the world today. If you bribe, it disturbs the universal brother. Allah says in Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse 19, Ya ayyuhallazina aamanu, O you believe, innama khamru wal maisuru, most certainly intoxicants and gambling. Wal anzaabu wal aslamu, dedication of stones, dedication of arrows, rishtu min amri shaitan, yina sayyidul handiwal, fashtani mula lukum fikun, abstain from the handiwal that you cross for. The Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying that alcohol, gambling, fortune telling, dedication of stone, all these are sayyidul handiwal. Action from the little gospel. All these things, it deserves the universe of the alcohol, gambling, fortune, dedication of souls. If you stay away from all these evil acts, which are signs of heaven, it will increase the universe of the Allah says in Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse 32, come not close to adultery, for it is a shameful deed, and evil opening other roads to evil. Adultery is prohibited in Islam. And Allah says in Surah Hujurat, chapter 49, verse number 11 and 12. And Allah says, let not one group of men laugh at the other. You will never know that the latter will be better than the former. Let not one group of women laugh at the other. You will never know the latter will be better than the former. Do not call each other with offensive nicknames. Do not spy on one another. For in many cases, suspicion is a sin. Do not backbite. Are you ready to eat the dead meat of your brother? Are you ready to eat the meat of your dead brother? Here Allah says that if you backbite, if you speak against someone behind his back, it is as though you are eating the meat of your dead brother. Eating the meat of human being is haram, but eating dead meat is double haram. Besides eating the meat, even the cannibals, they do not eat the meat of their own brothers. So Allah says that if you backbite, it is as though you are eating the meat of your dead brother. And Allah says to Surah Hosea, chapter 104, verse number 1, why you literally Hosea to the Hosea, woe to every kind of scandal among thy backbite. These are guidelines given in the Quran to promote universal brotherhood. But besides talking about universal brotherhood, Islam says you should exhibit universal brotherhood minimum 5 times every day in your practical life. I'm talking about the second pillar of Islam, that is Salah. When we offer Salah, we practically demonstrate universal brotherhood 5 times a day. Our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, especially in Sahih Bukhari, point number one, in the Book of Salah, in the book of Adam, chapter number 75, and then number 62. Where Adonis Melan said, the friend is good for Salah. The shoulder of the companion means that is the shoulder of the other companion. And a feet, that is the feet of the companion. The third part of the said, it's mentioned in Sunnah of point number 1, in the book of Salah, chapter number 245, and then number 666. But the Prophet, before Salah said, then close in your gaps, stand shoulder to shoulder, and do not leave any gap for the sake. So when we offer Salah, it is compulsory that the Muslim when we stand for Salah, we should stand shoulder to shoulder. And feet to feet. Irrespective whether you are rich or poor, whether a king or a pauper, when you stand for Salah, you stand shoulder to shoulder. Irrespective whether black or white, yellow or brown, when you stand for Salah, you stand shoulder to shoulder. Be Muslim. Have to practically demonstrate universal brotherhood minimum 5 times a day. The other very good example of universal brotherhood is the fifth pillar of Islam, that is Hajj. The Hajj is the biggest annual gathering in the world. And during Hajj, nowadays, about 4 million people come from different parts of the world, from America, from Canada, from UK, from Malaysia, from Indonesia, from India. 4 million people. And the men, they are dressed up in 2 pieces of unsoaked cloth, preferably white. So you cannot differentiate the person standing next to you, whether it's a king or a pauper. When you're in Ihram, the purpose of the Ihram is that all of them, they wear the same clothes, 2 pieces of unsold white cloth. You cannot identify the person standing next to you, whether it's him or not. And you see the Tarbiyah. Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. Labbaik Allahumma Labbaik. Here I come, O my Lord, here I come at your service. More than 4 million people from different parts of the world, of different nationality, different color. They come only at the service of the Lord. That is the best example of universalism. The main cornerstone of the Islamic faith is that there is only one sole creator, sustainer, and cherisher for all the human beings. The cornerstone of Islamic faith is for him that there is only one sole creator, sustainer, cherisher for all the human beings, irrespective of their black or white, yellow, brown, rich or poor, whether from America, Malaysia, India, Pakistan. Our Creator is the same. And this point is a single most important point for universal brotherhood. This point alone, that all the human beings have one sole common Creator, sustainer, and cherisher, is sufficient for universal brotherhood. That's the reason. Besides Islam, monotheism being the cornerstone of Islam, it is even the cornerstone of all the faiths. But unfortunately, in the passage of time, the importance to it has deteriorated. That's the reason if you read the scripture of all the major religions, all of them speak about believing and worshipping only one God. The Khalid Ibn Salih, the program of the Qiraat of Surah Al-Imran, chapter number 3, verse number 64, Allah says, Kul Yahya al-Kitab, Tayyib al-Kitab, Tayyib al-Kitab, come to common terms, ask and ask him. Which is the first term? Allah. That we worship Allah. Wala nushika bihi shayyo. That we associate with partner with him. Wala yatri zabar, jabar, that arba bihi lillah. That we erect not among ourselves. Or centric that we are Muslims bowing unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This verse of the Quran gives you a master key of how to speak with different types of people. Come to common terms as controlling power, a personal god or gods that we love worship. So basically religion means believing in God. So if we can understand the concept of God in the medieval religions, this is the best way to unite all the human beings together. So today, let us discuss the concept of God in the medieval religions, so that we can promote universalism. First, we'll discuss the concept of God in Hinduism. If you ask how many, that how many gods does he believe in? Some may say 3, some may say 100, some may say 1,000, while others will say, having 3 crores, 300 million. But if you ask a learned Hindu who is well versed with the scriptures, he will tell you that the Hindus should believe in worship only one God. But the common Hindu, he believes in a philosophy known as pantheism. Pantheism means the common Hindu believes that everything is God. The sun is God, the moon is God, the tree is God, the human being is God, the snake is God. What we Muslims believe that everything belongs to God, everything is God's. G-O-D with an apostrophe, yes. Everything belongs to God. The sun belongs to God, the moon belongs to God, the tree belongs to God, the human being belongs to God, the snake belongs to God. So the major difference between the common Hindu and the common Muslim is, the Hindu says everything is God, we Muslims say everything is God's. G-O-D with an apostrophe, yes. If we can solve this difference of apostrophe, yes, the Hindus and the Muslims will be united.
Darkness, those who
financial, things like water, fire,
and the verse continues, they are entered into more darkness, those who worship the Sakuti, those who worship the created in the cave, chair, idols. Who says that?
Deuteronomy chapter 40, verse 9.
The Vedas are the most sacred amongst all the scriptural things. And amongst the Vedas, the most important, most sacred Rig Ved. It's mentioned in Rig Ved, book number 1, hymn number 164, verse number 46. It comes up, Vibhavodha Dhanate. Truth is one, God is one. Satan and saints call him by different names.
The same message is repeated in Rig Ved, book number 10, hymn number 114, verse number 5.
That God is one, but saints call him by a variety of names. And there are no less than 33 attributes given to Almighty God in Rig Ved, book number 2, hymn number 1 alone. One of these attributes is
in Rig Ved, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse 3.
Brahma. Brahma is called as the Creator God. If you translate Creator in Arabic, it means Khalik. We Muslims have got no objection if someone calls Almighty God as Khalik or Creator or Brahma. But if someone says Brahma is Almighty God who has got four heads and on each head is a crown, you Muslims take strong exception to it. Because you are going against the verses of Parishad. Chapter number 4, awesome and ending, which says, Nardasipati Maski, of that God, there is no Pratima, there is no image, there is no idol, there is no picture, there is no painting, there is no portrait, there is no statue, there is no sculpture. The other attribute given for Almighty God in Rig Ved, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3, is Vishnu. Vishnu is called as the sustainer God, the cherisher. If you translate sustainer or cherisher to Arabic, it is somewhat similar to God. We Muslims have got no objection if someone calls Almighty God as Rab, or cherisher, or sustainer, or Vishnu. But if someone says Vishnu is Almighty God, who's traveling on the sea, on a bed of snakes, who has got four hands, on one hand is the chakra, the other is the discus, and flying on the bird by the name of Garuda, we Muslims take strong objection to it. Because from going to the Prince of chapter number 32, verse number 3, he says, Nartasya Pratima Asti, of that God, there is no Pratima, there is no image, there is no idol, there is no picture, there is no portrait, there is no painting, there is no sculpture, there is no statue. It is further mentioned in Rig Ved, book number 8, hymn number 1, verse number 1. My children, the Sansaris, do not worship him except the one and only. Praise him alone. It's mentioned in Rig Ved, book number 6, hymn number 45, verse number 16. It says, Ya ek Ushtihi. Praise him alone, one God. Only praise him. And the Brahma Sutra of Hinduism, the fundamental creed of Hinduism is Ekka Brahman Dyukya Raste Nena Raste Kichar. Bhagwan Ek Hai, Dusra Nahi Hai, Nahi Hai, Nahi Hai, Zara Bhi Nahi Hai. There is only one God, not a second one, not at all, not in the least. So if you read the Hindu scripture, you understand the concept of God in Hinduism and understand Hinduism in the right perspective, and that will help to increase the brotherhood between the Hindus and Muslims. Let's try and understand the concept of God in Judaism. It's mentioned in the Old Testament in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 6, verse number 4. Moses being the one said, Shema Israel, at the name of Echa. It's a Hebrew quotation which means, Your Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter 43, verse 11. Even I am Lord, and there is no Savior besides me. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter 45, verse number 5. I am God, and there is none like me. There is no God besides me. It's mentioned in the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verse number 9. I am God, and there is none like me. I am God, and there is no one besides me.
He saw the mention book of Exodus, chapter 20, verse 3 to 5. He said, thou shalt have no other God beside me. Almighty God say, that thou shalt have no other God beside me. Thou shalt not make unto thee any graven image of anything, of any likeness in heaven above, in the earth beneath, in the water beneath the earth. Thou shalt not bow unto them, nor serve them. For I, thy God, thy Lord, is a jealous God. The verse of the Bible is strictly private and worship. And making any image of God. Same is repeated in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 5, verse number 7 to 9, the Almighty God says, thou shalt have none other God besides me. Thou shalt not make any graven image of anything, of any likeness, in the heaven above, in the earth beneath, in the water under the earth. Thou shalt not bow down to them, nor serve them. For I, thy God, thy Lord, is a jealous God. So if you read the Jewish scriptures, you shall understand the concept of God in Judaism. And this will increase the brotherhood between the Jews and the Muslims and the Jews. Let's understand the concept of God in Christianity. Before I discuss the concept of God in Christianity, I would like to make a few points clear. Islam is the only non-Christian faith which makes it an article of faith believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We believe that he was the Messiah, God's in Christ. We believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention, which many modern day Christians do not believe. We believe that he came back to the dead with God's permission. We believe that he both born blind and never with God's permission. The Christians and Muslims, they are together. But when we ask, then where is the parting of faith? The parting of faith is that most of the Christians believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was Almighty God and he gave divinity. In fact, if you read the Bible, there is not a single unequivocal statement. In the complete Bible, when Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself says that I am God, always worship. I would like to repeat that if any Christian can point out a single unequivocal statement from any verse of the Bible, which is said by Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, where he says that I am God, or where he says worship me, I, Zakir Naik, am ready to accept Christianity today. I am ready to put my hand on the guillotine. If any Christian can point out from any version of the Bible a single unequivocal verse in the Bible, a single unambiguous verse in the Bible, where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he says worship me, I am ready to accept Christianity. In fact, if you read the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter 14, verse 28. Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter 10, verse 29, my Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter 12, verse 28, I cast out devil with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter 11, verse 20, I with the finger of God cast out devil. Gospel of God, chapter 5, verse 30, I cast out devil. That means if you want to go to paradise,
you have to be better than the Jews. And you have to follow all the commandments, what is mentioned in the Old Testament. For all what I said in the Old Testament, that God is one, you don't have to make images, have to be followed by the Christians if they want to go to heaven. Jesus Christ, please, we are one and our community. In fact, he said, especially the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 24, he says, the words that you heard are not mine, but my Father's who has sent me. Especially in the Gospel of John, chapter number 17, verse number 3, Jesus Christ, please, we are one and said, this is life eternal, so that we may know one true God and Jesus Christ, who thou hast sent. Especially in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 19, verse 16 and 17, once a man approaches Jesus, he speaks to him, and tells him, good master, what good things should I do so that I will enter into the life, so that I will go to paradise? So Jesus Christ, speaks to him, and says, why thou callest me good? He was said, God, why thou callest me good? There's only one good, that is Almighty God. And if thou want to enter into the life, you keep the commandments. He never said, that you believe that I died on the cross for your sin. He never said that you believe I'm born and go to paradise. If you want to enter eternal life, if you want to go to paradise, you keep the commandments. And still he mentioned the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse 22. Even of if I, listen to this, Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you, by wonders and miracles and signs, which God did by him and your witness to. A man approved of God amongst you, by wonders and miracles and signs, which God did by and you were destroyed. When Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was asked, that which is the first of the commandment, he repeated word with him what was said by Moses, peace be upon him. Especially the Gospel of Mark, chapter number 12, verse number 29, where Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, says, Shema Israel, at the name of thy God. It's the Hebrew quotation, which means, Yehovah Israel, the Lord, our God, is on us. So if you read the Bible, you should understand the concept of God in Christianity, which will help you increase the brotherhood between the Christians, the Muslims, the Hindus, and the Jews. Let's discuss the concept of God in Islam. The best reply that any Muslim can give you regarding the concept of God in Islam is quote to you Surah Ikhlas, chapter 112, verse number 1 and 4, which says, Kul wa Allah wa. Say, He is Allah and only. Allah Hassan. Allah, the absolute and eternal. Lam yalid wa lam yulad. He begets not, nor is begotten. Wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There is nothing like him. This is a four-line definition. Given in the Quran, Surah Ikhlas, chapter 112, verse 1 to 4, which is the litmus test for theology. Theology is God, theology we study of God. Surah Ikhlas is the litmus test for theology. Anyone says that so-and-so candidate is God, if that candidate fits in the four-line definition, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that candidate as God. The first is, Qul Allah Ahad. Say Allah Ahad only. Number two, Allah Hasamad. Allah, the absolute and eternal. Number three, Lam yalid wa lam yulad. If he gets not, nor is he gotten. Number four, wa lam yakul lahu kufuwan ahad. There's nothing like him. This is a four-line definition. Our Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, given in the glorious Quran, any person says so and so candidate is God, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting the candidate as God. This is the touchstone of theology. You will know what's the touchstone when you go buy gold. The goldsmith, and you want to check how pure the gold is. The goldsmith takes the gold and rubs it against the touchstone. And depending upon the color, he tells you that this gold may be 24 carat, may be 22 carat, may be 18 carat, or he may tell you it's not gold at all, because all that glitters is not gold. So Surah Ikhlas is the touchstone of theology. Anyone says so and so candidate is God, you put him to the test of Surah Ikhlas. If he passes, he is a true God, otherwise he is a fake. Let's analyze regarding Bhagwan Rajneesh. There are some human beings who claim Bhagwan Rajneesh is God. Why? to Krishnananda Sai. Sri Krishnananda time, one of my Hindu brothers, he told me, brother Sake, we Hindus don't consider Bhagavan as English to be God. I said, I never said Hindus consider Bhagavan as English to be God. I have read the Hindu scriptures, no one in the Hindu scriptures that say that Bhagavan is English to be God. I said, how do human beings consider him to be God? So let us put this Bhagavan as English to the best possible extent. The first is, pull for Allah. Say, he is Allah only. Was Bhagavan Rajneeshwar only? Was he the only human being who claimed to be God? There are thousands of people who have claimed to be God, especially the country where I come from. There are tens of thousands of men who have claimed to be God in India. We have a very rich history for many centuries, and I come from that country, and I am proud to be a citizen of India. But in that country, we have many human beings in the past and even today. Today, who claims to be God? So, this is not the only one. The next is Allah, Samad. Allah, the absolute eternal, was Rajneesh absolute eternal. We know from his autobiography, he was suffering from chronic backache, from asthma, from diabetes mellitus. Imagine what might be God suffering from chronic backache, asthma, diabetes mellitus. And the third test is Lamina Lamina. If he is not, no one is God. We know from his autobiography, he was born in a place in Madhya Pradesh. He had a mother and a father who later on became his disciples. And in 1981, he goes to America. And he takes thousands of American for a ride. And in the state of Oregon, he starts a village known as Rajneeshpuram. And he takes thousands of Americans for a ride. Later on, the American government arrests him and puts him behind bars. And then he claims, the American government gave me soap poisoning. Imagine Almighty God gave me soap poisoning. In 1985, they kick him out of the country and he comes back to India. And in the city of Pune, he starts a center. He goes back to where he had started earlier. So he's really called Osho Guru. And